We're gonna do chapter 2 of this story. I need to do chapters 3, 2 through 4, but we're not gonna do them in big video. We're gonna do them in separate videos, but we're gonna redo this. It was too quick and we didn't get it done in time, so. Alright, this is chapter 2, Castle Intruder. That's what this chapter will be, and this is part of it. Where I was, as part of this. So we'll just start here at chapter 2.
Gingerbread hallways with rock candy doors, down the staircase made of mead glass, and through a cozy brick passage to Mrs. Buzz's sitting room. Paige, intrigued and worried, you follow her. She is quiet as you walk through the hallways of Buzz Castle. A scattered group of passing elves waves at you, saying, hello, your second miss. You go through one of the gingerbread hallways with rock candy doors, down the staircase made of mead glass, and through a cozy brick passage to Mrs. Buzz's sitting room. She offers you a chair next to the fireplace and sits across from you. You take the glass of peppermint tea that has been placed for you on an end table. She doesn't speak. It's hard to read her mood. She seems agitated, or maybe unhappy. You try to think of something you can talk about that suits your mutual interests. Page 4 of 4. I discussed the menu for the Christmas wrap-up tonight. Radio button. Checked. 1 of 4. I tell her about the healthy new aerial exercise program I'm running. I discuss the elegant new decorations we'll be putting up for the new year. I try to tell her happy joke. I tried. Next. Hey, Mrs. Claus, would
shelves are the best singers, you ask? She sighs and stares into the fire. I don't know. Which ones? The rapping department, you answer. She chuckles, but only wipes down her cheek. She wipes it away and says, I needed that. Next, checked. Plus falls silent again. Some kind of internal struggle plays out over her face. Then she buries her face in her hands and spills it all out at once. Oh, Rosewood, I don't know what to do. The castle has been breached, last ghost is missing, our supplies have been sabotaged, and there may be an assassination attempt on my life tonight. What? Why didn't you send for me earlier? Page 202. What? Why didn't you send for me earlier? But you're on the Council of Seven, who would dare to attack you? I'm so sorry, milady. What would you have me do? Next, it's all right, Rosewood. Let me think for a moment. You breathe deeply and keep a straight face, but your tea begins to cool and frost over as your emotions spill out. Mrs. Blood studiously takes no notice. I'm not sure if it's me they're going after. There are old secrets in this castle. The lady, who is behind this? Radio, page 202. The lady, who is behind this? If I'm going to help, I need to know what evidence you found. Last ghost is gone? Are they involved? Next? I suspect so, she answers. Involved or disposed of? The wards which were breached were deep in the interior of the castle. They would have needed an inside assistant. She takes a quick look for tea. Here's what I want you to do. The after party is starting soon. I need you to go out there and mix with the crowd for a minute. Make them feel good. But keep a watchful eye. I want you backstage during my speech as my replacement head of security. And I'll need your help assessing our losses afterward. Pick, your head is reeling as you walk through the hallways and out onto the auditorium floor. But you always obey Mrs. Claus. You look askance at each elf you pass. Your head is reeling as you walk through the hallways and out onto the auditorium floor. But you always obey Mrs. Claus. You look askance at each elf you pass. Thoughts fly through your mind. I could ask these elves if they've noticed anything unusual tonight. Any of them could be traitors. I'll try to find anything out of place. Page 3 of I could ask these elves if they've noticed any of them could be traitors. I'll try to find anything out of I have no time for this. Claus gave me a mission. I could ask these elves if they've noticed anything unusual tonight. Next, you stop a fresh-faced young elf and ask him if he's seen anything odd tonight. Yes. I saw skeptical scholar in the infirmary getting toy briefs pulled out of his backside. Apparently, he slipped during the delivery and the elf notices your impatient look. Well, there's also a rumor going around that Mrs. Claus is upset. Nobody seems to know why, though. You thank him and send him on his way. So people don't know everything, that's good. You make your way to the party. Page 2. The elf notices your the first thing you notice as you walk into the party is that all the elves are nervous. A group of tall, knotted elves is glowering in the corner, and you can see that they've brought their bells. A couple of tall trolls from the new exchange program are getting scowls from everyone. There has to be a way to calm the crowd down. I start up a punch drinking contest. I'll participate, of course. Page 4 of 4. I stick on a smile and chant, next, and you stand on a table and try to get the audience's attention, but the crowd is loud and no one really notices you. You attract a few nearby elves, and you challenge them to a drinking contest, hoping that it will catch on with everyone else. An open barrel of Malazan is pushed up to the table, and you dip in your mugs and get started. Considering that you don't like mallow ale at all, it goes surprisingly well, right up until the point that you tumble off the table and into the barrel.
Uh-oh.
Page 2, but at least it gets everyone's attention. The nervous, they look like one that you remember from a different party of after everything dies down. You wander around the room. You keep an eye out as you go along. Near the back of the room, you spy an elf that looks familiar, a little rock elf. They look like one that you remember from a different party a few decades back. This rock elf was friends with Flicker and Flame before Flame went bad. A lot of people left the organization back then to follow Flicker and Flame, and you could have sworn this elf was one of them. Page 4, they look like one that you remember. That was years ago. And you follow the rock elf. Are almost caught up to them, you come across a whole herd of rock elves, with your target headed straight into the crowd. You're going to lose them if you don't do something. Page 5. There must be another rock elf around here who can help. It's harder than it seems. The rock elf is only the size of a cat, and they keep... There must be another rock elf around here who can help me track them. I'll test out my new tracker drone. I blend into the shadows and follow closely. I morph into a rock elf and join the group. Hopefully, they don't notice a difference. There must be another rock elf around here who can help me track them. I'll test out my new tracker drone. I'll test out next. You pull out your new drone, a delicate mechanical ferret. You wind it up and send it a mental image of the rock elf you're tracking, then place it gently on the floor, and it shudders into motion. Soon it is flitting and hopping from partygoer to partygoer. You smile in triumph, and follow it quickly. The rock elf takes a tortuous path across the room, weaving over and under partygoers and decorations, but the signal sent on your mind by the drone never fades. Soon, you can see your target. Page 2. You are closing in on the rock elf. When you wind it up and send it a mem. You take off, activate the communications device, and broadcast instructions to the Sigma Team Red, do you copy? You whisper. Page 4 of Sigma Team Red, do you copy? You whisper. This is Sigma 5, I copy, you hear. I am in pursuit. Suspect is a rock elf, in lower quadrant 7. Copy. What are your orders? Keep misses. Close safe. Radio button. Check. Monitor the guests. Watch for anyone suspicious. Keep misses. Close safe. Secure the castle perimeter. Don't let them escape. Monitor the guests. Watch for anyone suspicious. Keep misses. Close. Next. But you race down the hallway and do your best to catch up with them. The patter of hard little feet comes from ahead and to the right. With a burst of speed, you round the corner. There they are. They peer over their shoulder and cry out. Anxious to dodge you, they dive down a flight of stairs. But you aren't second list checker for nothing. You throw yourself down the stairs, landing nimbly at the bottom. Page 2 is your target tries to escape down the lock. A shortcut would help you catch up to the rock elf. There are 2 or 3 ways to get there quicker, but each of them goes through the private quarters of some guests. Of course, you can bash your way in, but they might cause you some problems. Page 3 of the Emerald Empress's official envoy has an enormous room that spans the length of these hallways. You could go straight through to the end. But the Empress is one of the Fey world's most powerful monarchs, and her envoy demands respect, formality, and proper conduct. You'd have to figure out the way to barrel through a room in the most polite way possible or face the wrath of someone much stronger than yourself. You either need your best manners or a very open mind. Page 5 of Alternatively, you could also go up a floor 2-3 near the Frost Giant's rooms. There's a servant's staircase in the back of his rooms that leads right to the end of the Will O' Wisp's hallway. But he's irritable, foul-tempered, and resentful for having to humble himself and beg for shelter. He'll throw you right out again if you're not stern with him. This is definitely not a time to be cheerful and happy. And, finally, there are the kitchens 1 floor below, which run through the entire building. But the old, rotund head cook simmering stew holds a grudge like no one else and takes elves who sneak treats. You better not go that way unless you're sure that you can restrain your appetite or prove that you've been following the rules. Page 6 of 6. And, finally, there are the kitchens 1 floor below. I'll try my luck with the Empress's envoy. I'll bully my way through previous rooms. I'll brave the kitchens and the wrath of simmering stew. Page 6 of 6. I'll brave the kitchens and... Next. You compose yourself in an instant and open the door. The room is impenetrably dark. Following the ancient pattern, you kneel, kiss the floor, take another step, kneel, and kiss the floor. Then you repeat this 7 times. The envoy's voice slithers into your brain. The frost blaze, crown, the numbing sky. I chose you at midnight, the darkest hour. You bow again, and respond vocally, trying to remember the ancient words of the emerald breathing ritual. You have to wing it a little bit. The blazing mantle is mine. I find you under the noonday sun. Page 2. You bow again, and respond. The lights flicker on, and you see the envoy in their current form. They look like you, of course, since you came alone. The envoy's imitations used to bother you, but once you saw their true form, you never begrudged them again. What do you say to the envoy? May I pass through your rooms? Radio button. Check page 3 of 3. May I pass through your rooms? I'm pursuing a traitor. Pardon the intrusion. In the name of Mrs. Floss, let me through. I'm pursuing a traitor. I'm pursuing a tr- next. The envoy's mouth twitches, and the envoy's face says, feel free to intrude on this side. I'm going to turn the favor one of these days. They smile with your smile and bow at your waist, indicating the end of the room. You race as fast as you can through the room, but the door is far away. The room seems to be melting a bit near the end, as the envoy loses the trust in holding together this version of reality. The door opens for you as the lights go out, and it slams behind you as you exit. Page 2 of 2. The envoy's mouth twitches, and in your voice they smile with your smile and bow with your waist, indicating the end of the room. You race as fast as you can through the rooms, but the door is far. Next button. Next button. There, you catch your breath, then race around the corner, running smack into the rock elf. Both of you are knocked to the floor, and a glowing device rolls from the elf's body and across the floor. The rock elf scrambles to where and darts down the hallway. You scoop up the device and chase after them. There's nowhere for them to go. You quickly corner them in a short hallway ending in a stained glass window. What are you doing here? You demand. Who do you work for? Page 2 of 5. The rock elf slowly backs up towards the window and says, I'm working for all of us. Changes are coming. Rosewood unicorn. Big changes. Come with me quietly and you won't get hurt, you say. The rock elf shakes her head and jumps backward through the window. You stare in shock as they plummet far below. Right before they hit the rocks below, a shadowy figure swoops to catch them. Page 3 of When the Flying Creature, you stand still, in shock. Glancing at the glowing device which fell from the rock elf, you can see that it's made of some sort of carbuncle embedded in an iron ring. Someone's been gem-smithing again. You turn around only to see yourself surrounded by anxious elves. A sec when the flying creature and the rock elf emerge into the light. They are far away, but you can clearly see that the rock elf is riding one of the reindeer. Are some of the reindeer working with flickering flame? You stand still, in shock. Glancing at the glowing device which fell from the rock elf, you can see that it's made of some sort of carbuncle embedded in an iron ring. Someone's been gem-smithing again. You turn around and a second-generation elf dentist that you recognize asks you, Unicorn, what's going on? They seem intimidated by the recent baron, but curious about the ruckus. Page 4 of 5. You turn around and I ask them to trust me and tell them that I'll take care of it. Keeping aloof from everyone in the castle, I offered them my friendship. Page 4 of Keeping aloof from everyone, stalking the castle halls at night like a cat. I claiming that everything security did was confidential. I shut that claiming that next button. That's just not the way things work at Claw's castle. It's more of an open system, and Glass Ghost needed to work in that system. But you never would have suspected them of treason. They had a perfect track record. It's an enigma, you suppose. Mrs. Buzz's speech begins, but you are now backstage, keeping a watchful eye over the audience. Nothing further happens until the speech is over and she joins you. Page 2 of Rosewood. Thank you. What you explain everything. Cheer me up. She sighs and looks away. Veteran Flame was never like that. He wasn't consistent. That's why I gave him that name when I took him in. I knew he would be like this. Everyone warned me. She looks back at you. I know what you're thinking. Why did I take him in at all? She puts a hand on your shoulder. I have survived when so many of the old ones have failed and died. It gets unbearably lonely at times. Sometimes it's better to have some excitement in life. To take on a challenge and really live, instead of just existing for century after century. I just feel sorry for how it's affected all of you. Page 2 of 4. She looks back at you. I know. Mrs. Claus reaches her gloved hand through the pool of frustration. She doesn't seem to take notice of your violent emotion, but you know it has to be uncomfortable. She creates a bridge of ice with one hand, which she crosses to find her closed trapdoor. page 3 of nice of him to close it after he went through, you say. The goal matches automatically, she says. To keep piercing. Given the sophistication level of this theft, no. She unlocks a neat accepted trapdoor, and the platter pot ash billows up. There's a fire billow, you explain. She sniffs the air for a bit. Then she says, it's mostly smoke. We'll need to clear it away, and dives through the trapdoor to the ground below. Page 4. She sniffs the air for a bit. I follow her immediately. Radio button. I hesitate before going in. I trust Mrs. Quast. I look to see if anyone followed us, then dive in. I trust Mrs. I trust Miss. Next, you take a quick look around you. No one's around, so you dive down through the trapdoor. The trapdoor. A strong wind boils up out of nowhere and blows the smoke away from you. You see Mrs. Quast standing a few feet away. Her right hand is stretched forward, channeling the wind. The smoke boils and surfaces as it's pushed back, but it has nowhere to go. Rosewood, says Mrs. Claus, we need to make an opening to get the smoke out. Page 2, Rosewood, says Mrs. I turn into a giant badger and burrow through a wall. Radio, I use smoke and fog all the time, for cover and for magic tricks. I know how to get rid of it. I climb back up to the trapdoor and try to pick the lock. I use smoke. Next, I'm hoping to impress Mrs. Claus. You strike a dramatic pose and snap your fingers. A small flask appears, the one you used for cleaning up the smoke after last year's talent show. You turn to me. Tell me. suffering from a long time ago. Greece?
The center of the miniature village contains a white dress. Oh.
found with the wool belt in the Knot of Hercules. Nearby hangs an ornate, jeweled robe. An air of great age lies on the cavern. I didn't know you kept your wedding dress, you say. She smiles and says, yes, with the entire town we were wedding. The marriage of Diana and Saint Nicholas. She smiles and says, yes, with the entire town we were wed in. The marriage of Diana and Saint Nicholas. You remember that day. She looked stunning in her simple dress, with tiny snowflakes following her as she walked. You were in awe of her at the time, proud to be in the service of such a regal queen, and intrigued by her exuberant bloom. Page 7. You remember that day. Her smile falters a bit. You know she's thinking about her husband's death. I reach out and take her hand for comfort. I remain respectfully silent. I know how you feel, milady. I'm here for you. Page 7. I know how you feel, milady. I'm here for you. I remain respectfully silent. I reach out and take her hand for comfort. I know how you find. Next, but she looks at you and smiles, but there's something else in her eyes. You feel it, too. You're both quiet for a long time, almost uncomfortably long. Then she blinks, and, with a half smile, says, thanks, Rosewood. I'm glad I can count on you. The moment passes. At the end of the arcade is a plain wooden door. A silk string across the door has been neatly severed. The door opens easily when you push it. You don't want to offend Mrs. Claus, but you have to ask. Page 2. Not much of a protection, is it? The door opens easily when you push it. You don't want to offend Mrs. Claus, but you have to ask. You know I trust you, but I have to ask about this ring. Radio button. Not much of a protection, is it? Radio button. Checked. 1 of 4. You know I trust you, but I have to ask about this ring. This silk is gorgeous, but I'm sure it's more than just decorative. Radio button. I'm curious. Why didn't the string do anything? Radio button. This silk is gorgeous. But I'm sure it's more than just decorative. Next, she smiles and says, yes, you've always had a taste for the fine. Let me tell you about this string. She says, this was one of my most powerful wards. I imbued this string on the day that we were married, and saved it. Once Anna died, I knew I needed to keep his heart safe. She bends down to pick up an obsidian knife. It is positively glowing with hatred. They must have gotten me with this. Who knows what unsavory practices they used to fill this woman's power. She smiles and says, yes, you've always had a taste for the fine. Let me tell you about this string. She says, this was one of my most powerful wards. I imbued this string on the day that we were married, and saved it. Once Anna died, I knew I needed to keep his heart safe. She bends down to pick up an obsidian knife. It is positively glowing with hatred. They must have gotten me with this. Who knows what unsavory practices they used to fill this one with power. Page 1 of 5, page 2 of 5. You climb through a narrow She crushes the obsidian dagger with her fist, and you move through the doorway and into a tight cave. You climb through a narrow tube and over a drift to get to the next cavern. At first glance, it looks like it's filled with a dense forest of birch trees, covered in white ash. But then you realize that it is a forest of stone, with the dust of ages gathered on the branches. There are no labels on the walls here, and probably won't be any more. This is from before Mrs. Claus had her husband. Page 3 of Mrs. Claus follows your eyes as they scan the room. She smiles. I didn't want to leave my robe behind when I was driven from Tegia. This was the only way to preserve them. They would have rotted away thousands of years ago, otherwise. There are a few snapped-off branches in the trees. When you tell Mrs. Claus, she asks you to investigate. As you wander through the forest, looking for clues, you kick a stone chip. It flies through the air and hits a tree with a satisfying clack. You keep walking and kick another chip. Clack. Another chip. Clack. Page 4 of 5. You take another step. You take another step and the foot breaks through the rocky ground below. You're falling now, and at the bottom of the pit is a ragged ball of inky blackness that gives you a deeply unsettled feeling. It looks like a hole that has been ripped in the air, but there's nothing behind it. Unfortunately, you're falling straight towards it. Page 5 of, unfortunately, your fall it shifts into something smaller to avoid it. Summon and fire off a giant snowball to counteract my momentum. Summon and fire off a giant snowball to counteract my deploy the safety harness I've been working on. Deploy the safety harness I've been working on. shift into something smaller to avoid it. Deploy the safety heart, shift into next. You shift yourself into a cat and narrowly avoid the hole, smashing into the side of the pit instead. You climb out and shift back, laying on the ground for a moment. You pick yourself up again and look in alarm at the hole. The push button crash if you don't you shoot off near the hole. A chill runs up your back. It's frightening to think what the hole could have done to you. You scramble back from the plot, calling out applause. She runs to you in seconds, pulling you up, then you point to the hole. Page 2. You scramble back from the plot. It's some sort of, I don't know, a sort of nothing, a big hole in the earth, you say. Watch. You push a stick into it. Then she says, it's not like a black hole in the mortal world. Those distort space around them. This looks different, like a rift or tear. You ask, Flicker and Flame was a powerful magician, but I don't think even he could do this. Page 3 of 4. She shakes her head and says, no. I don't know anyone who could do this including herself. It's not here, but even she couldn't do it herself. There is more than she could do so. She shakes her head and says, no. I don't know anyone who could do this in either realm. The Emerald Empress might know, but even she couldn't do this herself. There is more going on in these caverns than simple theft. Should we do something with it? It seems dangerous, she says. She asks, do you have any ideas on how to make it? No matter what you do, it will be incredibly difficult. Page 4. I can shift into a caterpillar. I can encase it in pure, compressed candy cane. Radio button. Checked. I can encase it in pure, compressed candy cane. She asks, I can encase it in pure, compressed candy cane. I can shift into a caterpillar and cocoon it. Let it heal. I know a golem who's out at work. I'll see if she can guard it. I can weave intricate enchantments to trick others into avoiding it. I can shift into a caterpillar and cocoon. I can shift into a cat. Next. I'm not sure we have time for that, says Claws. There's a rare form of caterpillar in the red swamps that can spin a cocoon in 30 seconds. Misses. Claws nods and stands back. You concentrate on the creature's shape, smell, sound. Then you close your eyes and feel yourself shrinking. When you open them, you have become a red swamp webworm, exactly as you pictured. You squirm your way around underneath the hole in repeated circles. There's a rare form of caterpillar. You concentrate on the creature's shape, smell. Page 2. After you shift back, Mrs. Claws stick. You concentrate on the creature's shape, smell, sounds. Then you close your eyes and feel yourself shrinking. When you open them, you have become a red swamp webworm, exactly as you pictured. You squirm your way around underneath the hole in repeated circles until you reach the top and it is completely encased in shining gold thread. After you shift back, Mrs. Claws steps closer to the cocoon. She pokes it with a finger. Not very strong, she says. But it's repairing the damage. Webworms can heal anything. That's why they were hunted almost to extinction, you say. They can heal anomalies that no one has seen before, she asks. Page 3 of 3. Not very strong, but they can heal anomalies that no one has. Fear for yourself. The room already feels lighter. Next, but after the rip is now completely enclosed. You and Mrs. Claws step slowly away, careful not to disturb it. Your heart feels lighter. Mrs. Claws addresses you and walks further into the grove. Rosewood, I'm proud of you. This bodes well for your future. You smile in pride. Mrs. Claws is always supportive, but she never exaggerates. After you pass the middle of the grove, you stop her. Milady, I realized something about that rip we saw back there. Page 2. What is it? She asks, pausing her stride and turning to look at you. It reminded me of the log fence we had when we were staying in Asgard. I found a hole a wolf made underneath it. It looked a lot like that rip. It almost looks like something coming into our world forcefully, or leaving. Interesting theory, said Mrs. Claws. An outside intruder, it would explain a lot. But are they working with Flicker and Flame, or is it something else? Page 3. It reminded me of the log fence we had when we were staying in Asgard. A wolf made underneath it. It looked a lot like that rip. It almost looks like something coming into our world forcefully, or leaving. Interesting theory, said Mrs. Claws. An outside intruder, it would explain a lot. But are they working with Flicker and Flame, or is it something else? Next button. Mrs. Claws leads you down a dark staircase that opens up into the largest and oldest chamber yet. A sprawling city of pyramids, stadiums, and statues stretches around you. You have an entire city in here. Yes. statues. You are surprised to feel a pull from it. A ton of emotion. Mrs. Claus runs her hand over the stone. Page 2. Some of the carvers were bleeders, and viewed the statue. You try to take it all in. When you run a hand over one of the statues, you are surprised to feel a pull from it. A ton of emotion. Mrs. Claus runs her hand over the stone. Some of the carvers were bleeders, viewing the statues with their thoughts and feelings. They are also magnetic, here and in the mortal world. I never understood. When a gunfire hits the ground near the tomb, you can feel the activity of each bullet. It's your duty to protect Mrs. Claus. Page 3. I use a trick to switch our appearances to draw. A spray of gunfire hits the ground near the two of you. You can feel. I use a trick to switch our appearances. I summon a Christmas snowfall to blind the enemy. I release a dozen mouse spots to distract and sniff out the. I release a dozen mouse spots to distract and sniff out the enemy. I summon a crystal. I summon. Next. You pull a crystal snowflake from your pocket and throw it on the ground, brushing it under your feeling column on your memories of ice, winter, and frozen rivers and sleigh rides with silver bells. Snow swirls from the ceiling and surrounds you in the nearby buildings. Mrs. Claus pulls you up after her and runs with silent steps to the house. Shots, but they are far away and miss end. The two of you stop, and Mrs. Claus pulls you into a nearby entryway. Page 3 of Mrs. Claus puts her hand on your shoulder and strengthens your storm, turning it bitter cold. The temperature in the area plummets, and the gunshots stop. You take a look at the cause of all the trouble. It's a wind-up tin soldier with no label. As you pick it up to investigate, it dissolves into a pile of iron filings. When you look at Mrs. Claus, she turns to move on, and you follow. At Love and Max advertise next button. You take a look at page 3 of Mrs. Claus puts her hand on your You take a look at the cause of all the trouble. It's a wind-up tin soldier with no label. As you pick it up to investigate, it dissolves into a pile of iron filings. When you look at Mrs. Claus, she shrugs. She turns to move on, and you follow. Next button. You slide down once more into a smaller cavern. One filled with cats, giant limestone carvings of cats, murals depicting cats, and even a few
for Christmas. Major.
I didn't like when I punch you, I guess.
What can we get your mom for Christmas?
Connected to a deep lake in Scotland, she says, pointing to a small sluice against the wall. Anyone pulling up the trapdoor would have to pull up all of that water at once. But now, there's a counter spell blocking my own enchantment and keeping the water away. Page 3. After stretching, you bend down and lift. It comes up easily, and the water drains down. She nods. That's what I expected. It once connected to a deep lake in Scotland, she says, pointing to a small sluice against the wall. Anyone pulling up the trapdoor would have to pull up all of that water at once. But now, there's a counter spell blocking my own enchantment and keeping the water away. Next button. A musky, burnt odor surrounds the heat. It's the same smell you noticed hundreds of years ago, at a party, when Flicker and Flame was still called Loki. He had just won an epic eating contest against you, Bandit, an ice dragon, and a fire demon. Everyone has a distinct odor to their magic. You don't know yours, of course, just like you can't taste your own tongue. But some people say the smell of your magic makes gold rocks. Do you want me to scrub it? You ask her. Everyone has a distinct odor to their magic. You don't know yours, of course, just like you can't taste your own tongue. But some people say the smell of your magic is like old rocks. Do Do you want me to scrub it? You ask her. Page 2 of 3. She shrugs. Yes, Flicker and Flame is not someone to be trifled with. He was also stronger than you, but he wasn't reliable enough. And she shrugs. Yes, it's not good to keep an outsider's magic intact down here. Flicker and Flame is not someone to be trifled with. He was also stronger than you, but he wasn't reliable enough, as events later made clear. You crouch by the smell and concentrate. Magic can clear out magic if it's focused and refined as needed. You need to find a focus that suits your natural abilities. It shouldn't be hard. I literally focus it with a series of ground lenses. Page 3. I literally focus it with a series of ground lenses. I use them a lot in my experiments. Radio. I wear a circlet of holly from the Scottish Highlands. It embodies Christmas cheer. I wear a circlet of holly from the Scottish Highlands. You crouch by the smell and concentrate. I literally focus it with a series of ground lenses. I use them a lot in my experiments. I wear a circlet of holly from the Scottish Highlands. It embodies Christmas cheer. I use a tooth that a polar bear shaman traded me. It's useful to have that kind of connection. I wear a circlet of holly from the Scottish Highlands. I literally focus it with a series of ground lenses. I use them a lot in my experiments. Next, you look through your pouch for some lenses. All but one are cracked or scratched, so you grab the one. It's fairly small. Mrs. Claus is watching with a skeptical look on her face. She says, are you sure this is going to work? You give her a weak smile, then focus on your power. You pour your emotions and thoughts through the focus, trying to eliminate the counterspell. Your goal is to burn out the charm. Closing your eyes, you can almost smell the counterspell burning away. Page 2 of Rosewood, you hear Mrs. Claus exclaim. You open your eyes and find your focus on fire. With a shriek, you throw it to the ground, stamping it to bits. Mrs. Claus sighs and focuses on the counterspell herself. She burns it away, but she appears visibly drained. Once the spell is gone, the water begins to flood through the sluice and down the open hole. Mrs. Claus peers in for a moment. Page 3. She steps into the water with her black suede boots. The water quickly freezes over, forming a staircase to the ground below. She notices your look and says, Frost Wolf Leather. The best for winter boots? You shrink a little inside, remembering your days in a wolf pack, and she says, don't be so surprised. I was the goddess of the hunt, after all. And those who have crossed me will find that I have not changed. Underneath, she looks taller now, and shows her teeth as she smiles. She steps into the water with her black suede boots. The water quickly freezes over, forming a staircase to the ground below. She notices your look and says, Frost Wolf Leather. The best for winter boots? You shrink a little inside, remembering your days in a wolf pack, and she says, don't be so surprised. I was the goddess of the hunt, after all. And those who have crossed me will find that I have not changed. Underneath, she looks taller now, and shows her teeth as she smiles. Page 4 of 4. She extends her hand, and together you descend down to the most ancient caverns of all. Next, button. She extends her hand, which you take, and together you descend down to the most ancient caverns of all. Next, Miss, the air down here smells old as you. It's the smell of the young earth, before Christmas, before gods. You are in an egg-shaped enclosure. The room is dominated by a thick tree trunk. Roots grow from the top and from the bottom, no branches, a marvel of nature. The roots twist into the dirt walls and almost seem to form patterns. Mrs. Claus leads you to a small stone table near the trunk, with a few scattered items on it. A dry mushroom, a circlet of leaves, frozen moonbeam, and a small star made of silver, designed to look exactly like a birthmark. It was a gift from Claus, years ago. Page 2, Mrs. Claus leads you to a small... You try to remember to search the room, but you are distracted by the rush of memories. There are so many things here from your childhood, but you try to clear your head and focus on the search. I clear my head with a simple mantra I learned years ago. Radio button. Page 3 of 3. I clear my head with a simple mantra I learned years ago. I slap myself so I can get a grip. It's not fancy, but it works. I concentrate and remind myself of the importance of my mission. I left behind this simple world years ago. My life is more elegant now. I can do this. I clear my head with a simple mantra I learned years ago. Next, with it's true. When you are young, you have to be young. An acorn could be fascinating, or a puddle. But you work your way out of that. At Claus's side, you've become cultured, refined, and it feels right. With your mind. focus on searching for signs of incursion. You talk to Mrs. Plus as you go, what am I looking for here? What sort of protection did you have in this room? At Love and Max Advert, with your mind free, page 2. I had a simple ceiling here, done with power, but nothing complex. Settle has changed. Probably flicker and flame. You circle the central tree trunk. Signs of flicker and flame's presence. Instead, you find something else, a toy. Mrs. Claus comes over and you throw it to her. Puzzled, you look it over together. It's a small, purple plastic eggplant with anthropomorphic features. Its eyes are gray, and it has a special brown. It's labeled. Page 3 of Mr. Grumpy Head, you ask. She nods, and adds, by Crinkle Corp. You realize that your hands have gone numb where they are holding the grumpy head, and you drop it. It seems to absorb magical power, she says. You say with a sigh, thinking back to the twisted passage, and here in reality, you say, maybe 3. So we have 2 foes to deal with, Mrs. Claus shakes her head. It's too easy to classify others as foes. Flicker and Flame is the same now as he was when he worked with us. He is a creature of chaos. As for these others, they don't know us. And we don't know them. Let's say that our purposes are currently at odds. She looks at the dog. But we don't need the Santa Claus castle. We need to get rid of it, but it's clearly magic resistant. Page 4 of Buck misses. Claus shakes her head. It's too easy to classify others as foes. Flicker and Flame is the same. I propose disassembling it. It's risky, but maybe we'll learn something in the process. Page 5 of I propose disassembling it. I suggest shipping it to a discreet cat I know in Avalon. It would be safe there. I think the spell is magic training enchantment, but I have a few tricks up my sleeve. I subtly shift the spell's target to something else. I propose disassembling it. It's risky, but I propose disassembling it. It's risky, but maybe we'll learn something in the process. I suggest shifting it to a discreet cat I know in Avalon. It would be safe there. I think the spell is magic training enchantment, but I have a few tricks up my sleeve. I subtly shift the spell's target to something else. I can look next. As with Mrs. Claus's approval, you grab a slender piece of wood from the tree. You set the doll on the ground and pull out a green-white handkerchief. Covering the doll with a handkerchief, you channel your thoughts into your freshly plucked wand. As you concentrate, spidery, red lines appear through the handkerchief, tracing out the lines of power from the Mr. Grumpy Head doll itself. You carefully pick up the lines of force with the wand, shifting them from one side to the other. Page 3 of, but you get a little too eager, and the tip of your wand turns to ash and crumbles to the ground. Your enchanted handkerchief catches on fire and burns away in seconds. Frustrated, you give the Mr. Grumpy Head doll a couple of healthy kicks, putting a dent in the shale, but otherwise not succeeding in smashing it. Without comment, Mrs. Claus picks up the doll and squeezes it into powder with her bare hands, then walks away. Page 3 of, but you get a little too eager, frustrated, you give the Mr. Grumpy Head doll a couple of healthy kicks, but otherwise not succeeding in smashing it. Without comment, Mrs. Claus picks up the doll and squeezes it into powder with her bare hands, then walks away. Next, Mrs. Claus lays her hand on the tree trunk and it splits open with a whisper of sound. She runs her fingers over the edges and frowns. You notice that the edges are splintered and rough, as if they were recently forced. Together, you descend down the short flight of stairs into a stone room. The room is a mess. The walls are burned and chipped, and fragments of cloth and shrapnel litter the floor. Part of the walls seem twisted and warped, and it hurts your head to look straight at them. But you couldn't, anyway. Your eyes are fixed on a granite chest in the center of the room, its lid wide open, the final resting place for Santa's heart. It's empty. Page 2, Mrs. Claus lays her hand on a tree trunk and it splits open with the room is a mess. The walls are burned and chipped, and fragments of cloth and shrapnel litter the floor. Part of the wall seems twisted and warped, and it hurts your head to look straight at you. But you couldn't, anyway. Your eyes are fixed on a granite chest in the center of the room. It's lid wide open, the final resting place for Santa's heart. It's empty. Next, button. Nope, she slumps to the ground and rests against a wall, exhausted. It's gone. I knew it was gone, but I just had to see it. This means the end, Rosewood. You don't know what to say to that at all. Instead, you look at the tree. I didn't know this was down here, you say. Nobody did, said Mrs. Claus. I kept the existence of Santa's heart secret from everyone, except for one. She looks at you directly. anything when it comes to Mrs. Claus. I can believe pretty much anything when it comes to Mrs. Claus. Next button. I can't believe how far underground we are, except next button. Next. You can hide the hurt in your eyes. Mrs. Claus kneels down by you and says, Rosewood, I know I could have trusted you, and now I know that I shouldn't have trusted him. But I didn't even want to tell him. You know how he is, a charismatic spirit, a once god. I'm sorry. She takes your hand, and you walk away from the tomb. Next, but when you return to your room, exhausted and ready for sleep, you find a letter under your bed sheets. My dearest unicorn. It is with deep regret that I was unable to meet you again in the halls of Claus Castle. I found myself occupied with several charming new acquaintances. How often I've thought of you, of our days together, when you alone could challenge me in the insipid games and children's contests that are the heart and blood of our mutual home, Claus Castle. And how often I've thought of your noble and regal form, almost as impressive as my own. Page 2. How often I've thought of you, of our days together, when I know that you have chosen to serve Claus rather than joining me, but I implore you to reconsider. We are not like the mortals we observe. We are changeable stuff, the lifeblood of the world's nature incarnate. It's not our place to sit and hold on to dead tradition for millennia, stagnating and hoarding power like misers. We are made to rule, like the gods of old, and to be free under the sun. Claus is a tyrant, and a poor one at that. Watch her, after her loss tonight. She will tighten her death grip on Christmas and the elves like the desperate despot she is. Page 4. I know that you have chosen to serve Claus rather than there will always be a place at my side for those who value freedom, and I will always think well of you, my friend, my rival, my rosewood unicorn. With warmest regards. Flickering flame. Page 4 of 4. Flickering flame. Next, wrote as you finish the last line, the paper bursts loudly into flame and is gone. There is a knock at the door. It's Claus. It's not usual for her to come to your quarters like this. There's a hollow look in her eyes that you've never seen before. Rosewood, are you all right? I was passing by, and I thought I heard a fire here. After everything that happened tonight, I was worried. I tell Claus everything that happened. I want nothing to do with flame. Radio button, page 2-2. I tell Claus everything that happened. I want nothing to do with flame. I tell Claus what happened and pretend that I'm against everything Flame said. I tell her it was nothing, a gust of wind. I want to keep Flame's message secret. I make an excuse. I don't want to deal with Claus or Flame right next. You tell Claus about the letter. I'm not sure the emotions pass over your face as you describe Flame's sentiments. Anger, surprise, and jealousy? I'm glad you told me. Rosewood, Flicker and Flame. She stands a little taller, and brushes away her frightened look from earlier. I'm sorry for coming in, but I appreciate your help, Uniform. I'll see you tomorrow. She opens the door and is gone. With everything settled for the night, or is it morning now, you collapse into bed and fall into a deep and dreamless sleep. Page 3 of 3. I promise, you say, I'm sorry for coming in unannounced, but next chapter. I'm sorry for coming in unannounced, but I appreciate your help, Uniform. I'll see you tomorrow. She opens the door and is gone. With everything settled for the night, or is it morning now, you collapse into bed and fall into a deep and dreamless sleep. Voice over off.